Hello, everybody, and welcome to this presentation of the Elder Scrolls lore. The Divines are the gods of men on Tamriel. Wherever one travels within the Empire, one will find the symbols of their gods, temples and shrines erected in their honor, their totems worn and their names praised by commoner and nobleman alike. But who are the Divines? Where did they come from? What do they represent? And just how many Divines are there? Before the beginning of time, as far as the mortal understanding of time is concerned, the gods simply existed in the plane of Aetherius. A group of them collectively decided, or were persuaded, to use their great power to create a new realm. They materialized the plane which would be the home of mortal beings, Mundus. They would then set about forging the planet Nern, its landmasses, and its inhabitants. Partway through the process, the makers realized that their very essence was being sapped by the ordeal, never to recover. The beings who still had the power to return to Aetherius did so. The ones who weren't so lucky were forced to remain in Mundus. In time, they would come to be viewed and worshipped as deities by the mortal races. The race of men in Cyrodiil recognized certain of these gods as the Divines. That covers in a nutshell where the Divines came from, but how was the pantheon itself devised? To answer this, we need to look back at the foundation of Cyrodiil. The nation was born from a rapidly expanding slave revolt against the Heartland High Elves. The revolt culminated in a successful revolution under the leadership of Alessia, who was named Cyrodiil's first emperor. One of Queen Alessia's first priorities was to establish the sanctioned religion of her new nation. This was no simple task. Over their many generations of captivity, the slaves of the Heartland had come to adopt the gods of their masters as their own. Continuing this practice was out of the question, as the worship of purely elven gods would have infuriated Alessia's Nordic allies, without whom the revolution would surely have failed. Simply adopting the Nordic pantheon was also infeasible. Such a drastic change would have greatly lacked popular support. It also wouldn't have sat well with those elven kings who had assisted in Alessia's campaign, and were then left to hang on as vassals of the young empire. What she needed was to devise the perfect pantheon to please the populace and placate the powers of primary concern. Alessia must have been well-versed in world religions. The combination of deities she came up with is nothing short of brilliance. What follows is my own personal take on it. Fair warning, there's a good deal of speculation here, more than in any of my other videos up to now. I swear, however, that it's entirely based on in-game sources. The evidence is there. It just took a few creative leaps to make the connections. If you ever want to check my work, by the way, I always list my sources at the end of the video. Let's start with the easy ones. The decision of whom to place at the head of the pantheon was beyond obvious. Akatosh, the god of time, is worshipped throughout Tamriel almost universally. With rare exception, he's ranked among the higher deities of pretty much everyone. Besides that, Akatosh had bestowed his blessing upon Queen Alessia in the form of the Amulet of Kings. It was his intervention alone that kept the hordes of Oblivion at bay, giving the race of men a fighting chance at shedding their bonds. Alessia had a duty to Akatosh. She had pledged a sacred oath which forever tied them together. Akatosh, creator of time and Alessia's savior, is number one, without dispute. Another straightforward choice is Mara. The goddess of love and compassion is just as widely revered as Akatosh. Her worship can be traced all the way back to prehistory as a fertility goddess. While Akatosh is the creator of time, Mara is the mother of creation, referred to as the Mother Goddess by the people of Cyrodiil. No one has any fault with her, and none would dispute Mara's significance, so now we're up to two. We have a god of time and a god of creation. Now all we need is a god of life, and all the big stuff is covered. Here we have some options. There's Orke, god of mortality. A Nordic figure, but not an especially favored one. He was always attempting to ruin the Nords, having cursed them with their short lifespans. He even tried reducing their lives further to a mere 6 years. He was only prevented from doing so by the intervention of another god, whom we'll get to shortly. There's also Xarxes, the elven god of ancestry and lineage. Xarxes was a scribe to the gods from the beginning of time. Since then, he records the individual life stories of the elves, as well as the connections of ancestry binding them together. Mortal life on one hand, immortal legacy on the other. Put them in a mortar and pestle, grind them up, and you've just concocted a god of life and death, RK. The next potential candidate may have been the warrior god Sun, who is highly regarded in the Nordic pantheon and represents trials against adversity. That's certainly appropriate for a country of slaves turned citizens, but perhaps a little too warlike for some. Well, how about his brother, Stun? Also of high valor, but not quite as prominent. He's not a god to the elves, but he does at least show up in their mythology as a figure of legend. Use his elven name, and Stendar, god of justice and mercy, makes four. There was no subtlety in selecting Dibella, who was lifted from the Nordic pantheon without the slightest modification. This may have been of little concern, though. A goddess of love and beauty ought to have been innocuous to any potential critics. Besides, what's not to like? So now we have five. Kine, goddess of nature and the sky in the Nordic pantheon, is up next. Kine is most certainly important, but she's also implied to be the mother of Morehouse. Morehouse played a pivotal role in Alessia's uprising, as well as having been her lover and companion. Not including the guy's mother may have been imprudent, even if she wasn't already a god. Plus, having a god of the sky, hence a god of storms on your side, can't be a bad thing. Stretch her name out a bit, and Kinnereth is the sixth. The last figure of Nordic origin was the fairly obscure Junal, god of runes. He's so obscure that he eventually vanished from the Nords' mythology entirely. A god of runes could, by extension, be considered a god of language and mathematics. That sounds like a smart idea for a god. Change it up a little so he sounds less Nordic, and you get Julianos, god of wisdom and logic. Finally, to round out the ensemble, we should pick someone without a Nordic connection. Although it can't be someone too high up in the elven hierarchy. The god Zen, or alternatively Zen, depending on where you are, is the god of toil and payment in kind for the wood elves of Valenwood. In Somerset, he's acknowledged as one of the earlier aspects of the universe, coming into being as a direct result of the creation of time. He's just notable enough to impress the elves, but not so notable as to rile up the Nords. Change payment in kind to payment in cash, and now we have the ideal patron for our fledgling economy. Add a couple extra syllables so he fits in with the rest, and Zenithar, god of work and commerce, caps it off at 8. Here, ladies and gentlemen, is our pantheon, the 8 divines. But hold on a minute, we're not quite done here. There's an elephant in the room, and his name is Shezarr. Shezarr was highly praised by the men of the Heartland during Alessia's time. He had long been a part of their mythology, even since before their capture. If they worshipped anyone else prior to being enslaved, we don't know about it. Only Shezarr lasted through the generations between bondage and liberation. The Cyrodiilic creation myth says that Shezarr introduced the idea of creating the mortal realm to the other gods. He explained that great sacrifices would be required and that they may not succeed in their efforts. Despite this, the other gods were moved into action by the beauty of Shezarr's words. Once their holy work was complete, the gods of men looked upon their creation with pride and sought to teach the mortal races to live with love and honor. Thus are the race of men great in heart, humble, compassionate, and ambitious for a better world. That all sounds pretty good, so why not make him a divine? Well, Shezarr has other names. The Nords call him Shore, and they don't make him out to be nearly so benevolent. After the creation of the mortal world, the elven gods conspired against Shore to bring about his defeat and doom him to the underworld. They tore out his heart and used it as a standard to strike fear into the heart of the Nords. The Nords fought back, and when it became clear that the elven gods would lose, they hid away the heart so that Shore could never return. It is said, however, that Shore can return. Not as himself, but as an aspect whose sole purpose is to lead the Nords to victory and exact vengeance on the elves. One such example was Pelinal Whitestrake, whose opinions on elvenkind were made abundantly clear, having been written in the blood of their kings during the Alessian Uprising. The elves have another name for Shezarr. They call him Lorcan, and their view is somewhat different. Lorcan tricked the gods into creating Mundus with the intention of adding a source of instability to the universe. He did this in the name of his spiritual father, Sithis, universal force of chaos and darkness. Lorcan is considered the most unholy of the higher beings, his heart removed as punishment for his evil deeds. It gets worse. According to the elves, Lorcan had to be forcibly brought to justice to receive his punishment. He did not submit willingly, but went to war with the other gods. The leader of the combined force that took him down was Auriel, chief god of the elven pantheons, as well as the founder and ancestor of elven society. The first great hero of the elves is responsible for the destruction of the first great hero of man. Auriel is also considered a direct creation of Anuiel, the universal force of order and stability. Lorcan, a creation of chaos. These two are not mere enemies of each other. They represent opposing forces of nature on a cosmic scale. Oil and water, darkness and light, Twizzlers and red vines, order and chaos. The two simply do not mix, and attempting to do so will only lead to ruin. Naturally, Auriel is known to the race of men by a different name. Akatosh. Now you can see the conundrum. It's important to recognize that these differing accounts of Shezarr, Shore, Lorcan are simply a matter of perspective. All the different names, motivations, and the finer details that completely contradict each other can make this a very confusing story to assemble. However, the high-level sequence of events remains exactly the same no matter where you look. Anuiel and Sithis together shape the universe, with some balance between stability and chaos. Auriel increases stability by creating time. Lorcan adds a source of chaos by creating Mundus. The two clash, Auriel wins, Lorcan loses his heart, and an eternal rivalry between men and elves is born. Can we all agree on that? Good. We can now clearly see that making both Akatosh and Shezarr divines would have been an irreparable contradiction at the most basic level. Putting them together would have provoked righteous anger from the elves, but that's not the main concern. What's far more significant is the fact that it simply wouldn't have made sense, and everyone would have known it. It would have utterly destroyed the credibility of the entire religion before it got off the ground. For the reasons stated earlier, Akatosh had to be included. Therefore, Shezarr had to be left behind. Completely disavowing Shezarr, however, would have jeopardized the tender alliance with Skyrim. Sure is that big a deal up there. In the end, Alessia chose to recognize Shezarr not as a proper god, but as, quote, the spirit behind all human undertaking. This was a cop-out, but it was good enough for the Nords. The elves, as it turned out, weren't at all bothered by this either. This vague honorific left Shezarr in prime position to simply fade away with time, which is precisely what happened. There are sects within Cyrodiil who worship Shezarr, but even then he is called Shore, indicating a Nordic heritage. In the eyes of the Empire, Shezarr is all but completely forgotten. There you have it, the Eight Divines, a pantheon born not out of providence, but politics. A delicately balanced synthesis of Nordic and Elven traditions, purpose-built to fit the Empire of Cyrodiil within its place in the wider world. The results speak for themselves. It worked. By the time of the Third Era, Cyrodiil had seen centuries of conflict taking every possible form. The Divines weathered every storm and remained ever-present. After the death of Tiber Septim in the early Third Era, he ascended to the ranks of the gods as Talos. The Eight Divines then became the Nine, also known as the Eight and One. The missionaries of the Imperial cult saw to it that worship of the Nine spread to all corners of the Empire. Their mission, to lead a virtuous life and to help others do the same. They preached the Nine Virtues: humility, inspiration, piety, work, compassion, justice, ambition, learning, and civility. Their goal is to help and to protect one another. They believe that the strong and the wealthy have a greater responsibility to help those less fortunate. They provide services to all in need and just do good work. Contrary to most other religions of Tamriel, worship of the divines is considered a purely private and practical matter. It's not woven into every facet of society, and the cult was deliberately checked so as not to hold influence over any aspect of government. They are their own thing, sanctioned and highly respected by the Empire, but never taken too seriously. You can see how the Imperial cult came to be at least tolerated, if not respected, throughout Tamriel. We're starting to run long, but I think we have just enough time to talk about how the Nine were turned back to Eight. Between the years 171 and 175 of the Fourth Era, the Great War was fought between the Empire and the Aldmeri Dominion. To make a long story short, the Dominion won. Peace was negotiated and the White Gold Concordat was enacted. The most controversial term of the Concordat was the ban of Talos worship, stripping him of his divine status. I'm sure many of you are going to turn on me when I say this, but if you ask me, this was the right call. When you realize the level of destruction Tiber Septim left in his wake, it's easy to understand why. The Empire likes to ignore the more brutal chapters of Tiber's great conquest. Even if some such claims are exaggerated, certain parts are undeniable. And it wasn't just the elves who suffered, not that that should be any excuse. At best, Talos was so focused on expanding the Empire that he was willing to put some of his morals aside to get it done, the ends justifying the means. At worst, Talos was bloodthirsty and cruel, not at all above murder, betrayal, slaughter, and the use of doomsday weapons to achieve his goals. Either way, it doesn't exactly reflect the life of virtue being preached by the Imperial cult. Talos embodies the boundless ambition of men above all else. He is upheld as humanity's greatest hero, whose power is called upon to fight back against the oppression of the elves. Sound familiar? Don't misinterpret this. I'm not saying that Talos is Shezarr. What I'm saying is that, like Shezarr, what Talos represents goes so far as to create a contradiction. For a doctrine representing compassion, humility, doing no harm to others, and pledging aid and comfort to all those in need, deifying someone like Talos just doesn't make sense. There is a more practical reason as well. The Divines were established as an elegantly crafted hybrid of already existing ideologies. With the exception of Akatosh, none of them were chosen simply because they deserved it. It's not that they were the most powerful, the most important, the most relevant, or the most loved by the people. They're here because they were the best fit for what was required of them. The Divines were founded at a time when Cyrodiil's future was far from certain. A delicate balance had to be found in order to withstand the political pressure and ensure the nation's survival. Talos tipped the scales. At the height of Cyrodiil's power, this wasn't an issue. When the Empire found itself on the brink once again, however, balance had to be restored. If there was going to be any hope for the future of the Empire, Talos had to be let go. But do not despair, O faithful of Talos. For as long as the Empire endures, even in defeat, the Divines will never falter. The Eight provide guidance, protection, strength, inspiration, and hope for all who seek it. Even with the loss of Talos, the men of Cyrodiil do not stand alone, no matter what the next storm may bring. This has been Double Negative. Thank you very much for watching. I will see you on the next presentation of The Elder Scrolls Lore.